I wonder where
so, so I'll be admitting the first organization will be Nayi Disha Resource Center.
So I'll start.
One second, hold on.
So welcome everyone for the to the Dolphin Tank Series A. This is our third tank for the day, where we have over the entire event we'll have 25 NGOs which are willing which are pitching here to scale up their work across 5 tanks the entire day. The format of the event will have Living My Promise signatories who have agreed to act as dolphins for them and in principle agreed to support them. Dolphins are wiser than sharks and also kinder, hence the name. I'll also use this opportunity to talk about Living My Promise a bit here. Living My Promise is a community of like-minded Indians who have committed to giving 50% or more of their wealth to philanthropic causes either during their lifetime or in their wills. Promisers help each other and also to invite other advantaged people to join the community. Anyone with a net worth of about 1 CR can make this promise. The causes, the organizations, and the activities that you support are entirely your choice. And to know more about this initiative, please visit www.livingmypromise.in. The organizations which are pitching today have already set up their crowdfunding campaigns, the links for which are shared on our Facebook page in the comment section. So all our viewers listening today can also support the organizations if the organization impresses them, if their work impresses them. So I'll also, take a quick, make a quick introduction to our friendly dolphins for the day. First one that we have is Mr. Govind. He's actually, traveling, but has agreed to take out time for this. So Mr. Govind is currently a consultant at Aegon Zender. He's also a board member at Give India and chairperson at Social Venture Partner in India. Mr. Neeraj Sanghi is the CEO at Highway Concessions One Private Limited, a global infrastructure partners company. We also have Ms. Meera Shenoy, who is the founder of Not Just Art and Youth for Jobs, helping companies have an inclusive workforce. Youth for Jobs is India's largest in this space. And our last partner, dolphin for the day is Mr. Mukun. Mr. Mukun leads Boston Consulting Leadership and Talent Innovation Center in Asia Pacific. So a very warm welcome to all the dolphins. The format will be having the participants will pitch exactly for 3 minutes, after which they'll be asked to stop. We'll get into a 5 minutes of Q&A round with the dolphins, and after which we will seal the deal. Thank you so much, and we'll start with the event. The first on our list today is Nayi Disha, Nayi Disha Resource Center. Can we have Nayi Disha's presentation?
Hi. I don't have the access to share the presentation.
It's enabled now. Sorry.
Okay. No problem. Shall I wait for you to ask me to start?
Yes, just give me a minute. You can start now.
Yeah. So the pitch time is 3 minutes. And I thought to myself, 3 minutes is all it takes to shatter the dream of a young parent. In this case, I'm talking about Sandhya, a young parent from Indrapur, Uttar Pradesh, who got associated with us last year. After running around for 4 years, she finally got the diagnosis of autism for her child, which should have happened at 2 years. While she was trying to process what autism is, she came across a quack who not just duped her of her money in the name of cure, but she lost on the precious years of intervention. Schools have been refusing admission. Her son is completely dependent on her. And as if this is not bad enough, her in-laws continue to blame her for what has happened. And the husband has washed his hands off. And I'm still not talking about the elephant in the room, her worry which keeps her sleepless nights. It is a worry that what happens to my child after me? And this is not just a worry of Sandhya, but of 31 million families in India who have children with developmental disabilities. Not only are these conditions complex enough, but the society that we live in, with lack of information, stigma, lack of awareness, make it even harder for families. And this is where Nayi Disha pitches in as a lifelong partner for families, providing them with hand-holding support at every step. We do this because we believe that if families receive the right support at the right time, they can be the change agent for their children. We provide holistic support to families, keeping them in the center of our intervention. And as our logo suggests, inform, connect, empower, a mother like Sandhya can find information about autism, kya hai, main apne bacche se kaise baat karu, main apne bacche ke saath kaise khelu, to finding schools in her area, finding therapists in her area, and she can also be connected to peer groups, in her case, WhatsApp Hindi-based group that we have. And she is also empowered through our parent training programs, and Sandhya specifically attended one of these training programs. Knowing that mothers like Sandhya have various levels of digital accessibility, we provide our interventions through various channels, be it our phone-based helpline, our WhatsApp support groups, information through our YouTube channel or the platform or our printed resources for that matter. What started as an idea has become a thriving community of 11,500 families. And these are just numbers. What brings me satisfaction is that parents regard Nayi Disha as their own. Parents who have benefited from Nayi Disha have become parent champions, helping other parents in the community. But with this, we have barely scratched the surface. Our goal is to reach 10 lakh families in next 3 years. And we are seeking support of 7 lakh rupees for a new program that we have designed for newly diagnosed families for a support intervention of 6 months. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Can we have the Q&A and ask the questions from the audience, please? Anyone can go?
Yeah. So can you just say, this is Mukund, tell us a little bit more about what this this new program is that you're referring to. You said that you need the 7 lakhs for.
Yeah, so the actual budget is 12 lakhs, but we seem to have raised 5 lakhs already. We are looking at providing specific support for families as soon as they receive diagnosis. And we are looking at 3 conditions, autism, Down syndrome, and cerebral palsy. The idea is to provide families with support through a multi-layered support, which we already have in place, but focused on newly diagnosed families. So it would include having specific training for them to understand what the condition is, so that they don't spend 2 years trying to understand the condition. Providing, we have support groups already, but conduct support group meetings where they will meet senior parents who have already been through the condition, which will make their journey of acceptance and understanding easier. And of course, providing them with regular bites of information so that they can process and understand what this entire journey is going to be for them.
So what is different from what normally happens? I get your point that you're specifically focusing on reaching out to families with new diagnosis.
Yeah.
Is that the essential thrust? Because typically the support they're getting after that already, you're already set up for. I'm just trying to understand what specifically is.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is based on what we have seen in the community, Mukund. What is happening is, just like the exact case I told you about, a lot of young families are coming across quacks, and invariably we keep getting this thing of whether stem cell therapy will work, whether oxygen therapy will work. And we have had parents sell their apartments to provide with therapies which cost 5,000 rupees per session. So that is why, while we have, our intervention is lifelong, we are providing information at various stages of a child's life. But this program is designed from the very moment that the family gets diagnosed, so that they don't waste that time in reaching the quacks, and hopefully they do not lose their money as well as the child's precious years.
Okay, let me just pause to see if there are other questions. I have one more, but I don't want to dominate the...
Sure.
I had 2 quick questions to you, Prachi. One is that, can you tell me what are the specific outcomes you track in this program? And okay, I'll ask you the second later.
So what we will be looking at through this is, one, of course, number of families that we are reaching, but how many families quickly start with intervention in terms of therapies, they're not coming across quacks, and also what are the home-based interventions they start, because we strongly believe that what interventions are provided externally are for an hour, three times a week. But what the family does at home through their everyday parenting is what is really going to benefit the child. So these are the kind of questions we have tracked. And third very important point, of course, in 3 minutes I couldn't do justice to it, is caregivers' mental health also. Because parents go through hell for the first 2 years, blaming themselves, trying to explain to their family. So that's one more part of what we want to track.
And scale for you comes through your platform, or how are you envisaging your next stage of scale, Prachi?
Yeah, so actually our upgraded platform is going to be launched by the end of this month, which will make it available in multiple languages also. But scale will come through the platform, through our helpline support. Programs like this will be still closed group for a smaller section of parents, but it is the what we see is on everyday basis, we have about 700 people accessing the platform trying to get information. So definitely platform is the way to scale. Second thing we are focusing on is also providing support through WhatsApp-based interventions with WhatsApp for Business. Because not everyone accesses the platform, but everybody has, whoever has a smartphone has WhatsApp on their phone.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
So I'll make it a two-parter. How are you identifying and reaching out to newly diagnosed children and their parents, and what are the time frame in which this this platform is going to be built and the 7 lakh investment that you need?
So Mukun, just so I clarify, the platform has been there. It was launched in October of 2015. This is going to be the upgrade of the platform. The easiest way to reach families but it is harder to reach those professionals, the pediatricians and doctors who diagnose families. For example, in Hyderabad, we already work with children's hospitals like Rainbow, where as soon as a family is diagnosed, they refer them to Nairisha. Typically, in our kind of framework of healthcare, doctors do not have the time to counsel a family. And this is where we as Nairisha step in.
Got it. And the time frame of the investment into this new program?
So we have already started with those support groups. Can I just understand what exactly you mean by that?
You said 12 lakhs, you have 5 lakhs already, you need another 7 lakhs. Over what time period would you need to spend?
Once the program is launched, over a 12-month period is what we are looking at. So that we have the monthly sort of intervention.
Understood.
Thank you so much.
Good.
So I'll also use this opportunity to remind the audience that we have the crowdfunding campaigns links up on Facebook page. So if you're wishing to support the organization pitching, you can do that. Now we can quickly support the organization.
Yeah, so Gunjan, I'm happy to support the organization. Prachi, this sounds like fantastic work. I think we are both from the children themselves, the parents. I think this is really important. Gunjan, I'm not exactly familiar with what you need me to do at this point beyond saying this. So let me know what the specifics are, or whether that's taken offline, that's fine too.
Yes, we can take that offline. You can just tell maybe the amount that you would want to support.
I'll at least cover half your need, right? At least half of that, I think one should do. If it's okay, Gunjan, I'd like to, look at more specifics later and we can figure out exactly what it is.
No problem.
Okay. Sure. Thank you, Mohan, and I'm happy to provide more information that you'll be looking for. Thank you.
Absolutely. We can take that off. Yeah. Happy to.
Yes. Thank you.
Thanks, Gunjan, sir. I'll be happy to give a 1 lakh to the cause.
Thank you, Meera.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, Prachi.
Thank you. So should I exit or the...
Yes, you can exit.
Okay, I'll do it. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you and all the best.
Thank you. The next organization that we have, which will be pushing for us today, is Youth Dreamers Foundation. Anish, you can share your screen.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are. And you can start now.
Yeah. Just a kilometer away from NIT Patna, one of the premier colleges of the country, lies a small semi-aided girls' school. Students from Ayub Urdu Girls' School come from really conservative families, and their parents usually work as hawkers. Zara, 14-year-old girl who used to get beaten up by her elder brother just wanting to pursue an education. Her mother, Zara's mother, at one point of time, even used to struggle to pay 300 rupees per month for her daughter's education fees. But the scholarship money has taken a huge burden off her shoulders. Similarly, Ikra, who dropped out of a CBSE school earlier, would have dropped out of Ayub Urdu Girls' Schools as well had it not been for the scholarship money. Last year, 92 students from Ayub Urdu Girls' Schools got these scholarships. And each beneficiary has a different story to tell. Out of 82,000 schools in Bihar, students from 77,000 schools can't even apply for public scholarship schemes because either their institute or is not registered on the or verified on the national scholarship portal. On the other hand, even if the child manages to apply for any one of the public scholarship scheme, only 2 out of 10 applications get verified, either because her application got rejected due to lack of document or was wrongly filled. Hence, we at YDF work to improve the delivery of public scholarship schemes. We have now started using heavy tech to scrape data from websites like National Scholarship Portal and UDIS to identify institutes and students who are not receiving the benefits of the scholarship schemes. We also scrape data from NGO Darpan website to identify or locate organizations in their vicinity and reach out to them. We use and analyze all these data to form a cluster of in-need schools and a local organization that can support them. We partner with these local organizations and help them help the institutes to become scholarship ready and also help the students to apply for relevant scholarship schemes. In the last 4 years, we have helped around more than 7,600 students to get scholarships worth rupees 4 crores. We therefore request you to support us reach lakhs of Zeras and Ikras. We are looking for 25 lakhs to build and enhance our capabilities across operations, M&E, and government licensing functions. Thank you.
So just a quick reminder to the viewers listening about a crowdfunding campaign, which is shared on our Facebook page. We'll move into the Q&A round.
Yeah, hi, this is Govind. Two questions, actually just one actually. Your biggest focus therefore is on enabling students to get scholarships. Is that, understand it right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. And so far, how many students? You said about 7,000 odd that you've enabled?
7,673 students.
Oh. And just from a clarification perspective, the 25 lakhs that you would like to support will enable you to achieve what goal? What outcome?
To design a next level program and to reach many more students like this. Right now we are outreaching through intermediaries and local organizations. We would like to support government in facilitating the scholarship delivery bill. We would work with district nodal offices that they usually cater to 1,500 to 2,000 schools. one person is responsible for facilitating all those things. So we would want to build some program for to enable that person to handle such large amount.
No, of but students. would it translate to 7,600 students being reached in the next couple of years? Or what, give me some dimension of what the 25 lakhs would really mean to you.
It would be around 20x of that number.
So you'll be able to reach about 1,50,000 people over the next. Yeah. Would it be 2 years, 3 years, 4 years?
4 years.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is this a merit scholarship or is it merit cum mean scholarship or it's only mean scholarship?
It's merit cum mean scholarship.
Which means there will be a universe.
Yeah.
So if it was only means, there could be a very large universe and we don't have to define it. But if it is merit cum means or merit, and there is a universe. What do you think is the universe for such scholarship?
So it depends on various scholarship schemes. Right now, the scholarship scheme we are working on is pre-metric and post-metric minority affairs scholarship scheme, in which a student has to score more than 55% of marks and their family income should not exceed more than 1.5 lakhs per annum. Although most of the students who have less than 90,000 per annum family income, they only get the scholarship scheme, scholarship benefit as of now.
Just to follow up, do the students give back any money after they get a job or after they get entitled? Do they come back to you and say, thanks to the scholarship? Is it a repayable scholarship or is it a one-time given?
No, this is one-time given. We do not give scholarship money. We do not charge the students for that.
Thank you.
We have time for maybe two more questions.
Yeah, so let me ask a clarifying question. If I understand this correctly, there are lots of government schemes that provide lots of benefits in lots of areas. One of them is in education. You're saying people are not necessarily able to access the educator schemes because of all the inefficiencies in the government system. So what you're doing is helping people to, and I wouldn't be surprised. I know in agriculture, lots of the schemes don't end up getting used at all, right? So you have money which don't get used even though it's earmarked. Yeah. So is the focus on working with district level functionaries or block level functionaries so that the funds come through? You refer to technology as well. So which part or where is the focus of, oiling the machinery as in making the machinery work better? Is it the district level? Or is technology and access? What are we fixing?
So we are looking at it in two phases. Right now, we are using technology to reach the institutions directly. In the next phase, we want to reach it through district functionaries and help them cater to, let's say, each district functionary has to cater to 1,500 to 2,000 schools. And right now, they do not have any clear mandate how to facilitate that on the ground. So we would, in the third phase, in the next phase, enable those district functionaries as well.
I don't think we have time for any
questions. You're not audible.
Yeah, I'm saying I don't think we have time for any more questions, but do we have a question? If it's a short question, we can take it. Thank you. Thank you, Dolphins. Now we can get into the CLD support for the organization.
So my first point is that really happy what you're doing. Whatever you raise in the crowdfunding process, I think Gunjan mentioned that earlier. I'm happy to match that up to 2.5 lakhs as a match. And if I understand more about your program, I'm happy to then increase that funding thereafter.
Sure. Thank you.
So I'll use this opportunity again to talk about the crowdfunding. That's very important, and that the links are shared on our Facebook page in the comment section. So please go ahead and fund the organizations you like. Yes, Mr. Neeraj. Yeah, sir, you're on mute.
No, I had told you that I was more keen on Mumbai-based organizations where I can support them. And if you need any support, I'm always available. But I'll pick all 1 lakh.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Yogi. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, fine.
So next organization that we have now is IANCH Foundation. Can you share your screen and your presentation?
Yes, yes, yes. Should I start?
Can you make this full screen?
Yeah.
Yes, you can start.
Good afternoon. This is Sanish Kulkarni, founder of IANCH Foundation. IANCH works with youth at risk and children in conflict with the law. The improper rehabilitation of youth at risk further pushes them into a vicious cycle of poverty and delinquency. The reasons for improper rehabilitation are multiple, and primary among them is that we don't take into consideration the 21st century aspiration of today's youth. IANCH wishes to change this approach. Our approach is a combination of social emotional learning, art and talent based learning, and employable 21st century skills. Our aim is to transform these youth into self-aware individuals who are skillable, at the same time who are responsible citizens. In the previous years, we have trained the youth in long-term digital programs outside the observation home. We conduct art-based workshops inside the observation home, and we were a part of online radio initiative which aims at connecting observation homes across Maharashtra. These programs have given us a lot of learnings. And based on these learnings, in the long run, we wish to set up our own holistic residential training facility for these youth, which would act as an alternative to the observation home setup run today. But that is a long-term vision. So as of now, what we intend to do is work with the observation homes run by the state and provide them a support system by our youth upgrade program. The program would be run in association with the observation homes. The intended impact of the program would be to reduce the recidivism, that is repetition of crime by the youth, reduction in aggression and addictions, and improvement in their mental health. We also intend to improve the family relations of these youth because they play a key role in their rehabilitation, apart from the skills we intend to deliver. The result of this, all this would be, we would be able to make 600 youth skillable and aware at the end of 3 years. 180 youth would be enrolled in long-term programs once they are released from the observation home. And we wish to see 60 micro entrepreneurs emerging out of our program as a result of our program. Our ask from the Dolphins is sponsoring fellow-led youth upgrade program for one observation home for the first year. Apart from the financial support, what we really seek is mentoring and guidance, because mentoring and guidance has personally transformed me from being youth at risk to being a youth with power. Also, as organization, we have been benefited a lot from the mentoring we got from Unlimited, Pravaha, and TISS, because we are a team of young individuals looking to make change in the society. Thank you.
Can we have the please?
Sorry,
I'm saying we can have the question answers from the world. Questions from the world.
Ayash, you are essentially looking at building and developing skill centers for the digital aspects of for the youth. Is that true?
That is a part of what we do. We basically work with children in conflict with the law, who are earlier called juvenile delinquents. So we cannot use the term legally. That is the reason we term them as children in conflict with the law, as it is prescribed by the Juvenile Justice Act. So digital training is just a part of it.
Do you want the screen share right now, or can you stop sharing the screen so that
visible?
Thank you.
Ayansh, what will your aspiration be over the next 5 years? What will make you happy?
Ayansh, in the 5 years, in next 5 years, intend to create a model for the observation home setups which are run today. So there is a we want to be an alternative to the observation homes run today. That is our five-year vision. Because what we have seen is the environment which is there inside the observation home is not conducive for rehabilitation.
Excellent. Unless I missed it earlier, what success have you had so far?
So we have been running a long-term digital training program once the youth are bailed outside. And that program has trained 58 youth until now, since 2018.
Very nice.
And the long-term, short-term workshops which we run inside the observation home, we have almost reached 600 youth in the span of last 5 years.
Very nice.
We have time for questions, if any. Any more questions from the dolphins? We don't have more questions. I'll use this opportunity for the viewers. You know, you can also fund Ayanj Foundation through their crowdfunding link, which is shared on our Facebook page. And now can we have the support for the organization?
I'm just going to say, I think this is a very, you might be listening to fewer things being said by us, but I think I think we completely get the significance of what you're doing, right? I mean, addressing youth at risk is actually truly fantastic. I think from my perspective, I'm actually, silence is a little hard to take, right? So you don't know what's going on in people's minds. So I think, you know, I'm actually... just trying to get us, this is a short, very short span of time to fully understand this. And it feels like you're still, you know, working through what you're trying to do, right? So happy to stay in touch. You know, you mentioned mentoring, right? And maybe it'd be helpful to, you know, understand a bit more. But that's basically from my side, the reason you're, the way to interpret my silence, at least, is that I'm trying to understand exactly what we're doing and need a bit more information. Yeah, just. Don't take it otherwise.
Yeah, sure.
Same here. I would go a step further. I would like to invite you to present a more detailed presentation to my CSR team, and then let's see if we can do something from the CSR funds.
Sure.
Thank you so much. I'm sure this is also a great help to Ayanj. And
yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sanisha from. Wish you all the best.
Thank you so much.
Can we have the next organization?
And you can talk.
Yeah.
So the next organization that we have for today is Barefoot Edu Foundation. Wish you all the best.
Thank you. Hi, everyone.
Yeah, you can share your screen.
Just a second. Oh, is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay.
You can start now.
Great. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jonathan, the co-founder of Barefoot EDU Foundation, and we are on a mission to create a movement of empowered leaders that make education meaningful to children right now. 9 out of 10 children in India are expected to be left behind. This means that they may not develop basic academic skills like reading and writing, or these many 21st century skills that we talk about, such as thinking critically, or even more, they may not have self-worth. What's worse is that it is accepted that it will take approximately 100 years for children to catch up. We do not have 100 years. While principles are known to have a massive effect on student outcomes, and even more on their school as a whole, they fail to invest in school leadership. A national survey conducted by Niti Aayog pointed out that no principal in 10 states had received a single leadership-focused training. And Indian school principals have less skills than their peers in 7 other countries. The problem that we aim to address is that there are 1.5 million school principals that lack the mindset and the skills to create schools that provide children a good quality, holistic education. Our solution is an entrepreneurship coaching program for school principals. This helps them use limited resources effectively and increase student exposure to 21st century learning. Through online workshops, fortnightly coaching, and monthly peer learning circles, principals implement two 21st century projects in their school, at a school level and at the student level. We measure the impact that is created in the principal as an individual, in the school as a whole, and across the system. We so far have built the capacity of 80 principals, and more than 90% of them find our training to be practical and within their team's capacity to implement. Our ask is to help us scale by building a platform for principals with self-learning modules, M&E to track the progress of their projects, and a platform to share practices. With your support, we will digitize 100% of our content and reach 200 principals. That's approximately 200,000 students. You also have the option of supporting individual principals that are incubated with a higher degree of support. Our team comprises of alumni of Harvard University, Young India Fellowship, and the Teach for India Fellowship. UNESCO has recognized the potential of our program by dedicating an entire chapter to our work in their upcoming publication on the future of education. We believe in raising the bar for learning and ask you to believe in us and support us. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Can we have questions from the dolphins, please?
Yeah, Jonathan, this is very interesting to see. How do you get to the principals? I mean, you're in this with this app. Are we basically saying principals proactively download it and work with it? How are you getting to the principals? What's the target audience?
Sure. So thanks for that question. So far,
two questions there. Who's the target audience and how do you get to them?
Sure. So far, our target audience has been principals of low fee schools that charge approximately 1,500 rupees as fees, but we're aiming to scale into the government sector as well. We reach principals through two channels. One, by directly partnering with them through the rest of our work, and second, by partnerships with school aggregators and governments. What we believe is that there needs to be a blend of the social component as well as the technological component in order for principals to consume this content. And we're able to do this with the help of a school coach. So one, on the learning platform, there will be the content available, but we follow up with the principals using a school coach and help them to structure a quarterly implementation plan for the first year and an annual implementation plan for the second year while handholding them as they implement two projects. Once these two projects are implemented, it's our belief that they'll be able to carry this mindset to more such projects of their choice.
Okay, so I'm going to make a statement and tell me how you respond to it. Schools are so diverse, our geographical conditions are so diverse when you go from metro to rural to, you know, like semi-urban, etc. School situations are so diverse that you will need to focus on very specific interventions that you almost pre-decide that a school which is low fee, if they did A, B, C, can actually help, and the app actually works through a very systematic thing so that people can go through, the principals can actually do things over a specific period of time. And of course, the coaching, et cetera, all helps. So a lot of focus is going to be required. It might be a huge population, but we'll need to be very targeted to be able to make an impact. How would you respond to that, Jonathan? Agree, disagree?
Absolutely. So I will just share my screen to show you how we go about doing this. We have three programs, one where we implement directly in schools to understand the context, and this helps ground us to see what works, what brings about quick spontaneous changes. The second is an incubation program for school leaders where they are treated as entrepreneurs and they leverage their community knowledge in order to drive innovation. And the third is this component where we scale the practices that are known to work in that specific context. And these principals that are part of the incubation project, as well as our schools in which we implement, they act as centers of support for other schools. An example of how this manifests is we have Farid sir over here, who wanted to undertake fundraising as a project. And in the beginning of the pandemic, he had to sell his car in order to pay for teacher salaries. But 6 months through our program, since we targeted fundraising, he was able to fundraise for 50% of his teacher salary, as well as instead of taking a building on rent, bring six other schools together to take a building on rent so that they could increase the space and stick and follow COVID norms. He then presented these learnings to 50 other principals in the slums of Mumbai and helped them on their fundraising journey as they collectively set a target for 60 lakh, which is far beyond the capacity of what each of the schools would be able to manage to aim for individually, but collectively with these principals as nodal points and the school coaches to provide them support in the projects, it becomes helpful. With respect to narrowing down, we do have certain domains. For example, at the school level, we understand that projects may be adult literacy or involving adults, fundraising, etc. And at the learner level, we also have a certain set of projects which typically principals move towards, such as digitizing the school in some aspects to improve student learning, or project-based learning in the school, etc. So they do have the autonomy for project selection within a certain set, and how they plan for those projects to be to unfold is a negotiation between structure and flexibility.
If I may add, essentially the idea behind all our programs is to empower the stakeholder. So we do not want to be very prescriptive in our approach that you do X, Y, Z, and this is like, you know, this is what you follow. But we believe in co-creation. So there are certain guidelines and some certain guided projects that we offer when a school is not able to figure out how to improve themselves. But often we have found with most of our principals, they are able to understand what is it that is needed. So some of our school principals, for example, are taking up projects for parent vocational training because parents are not able to pay the school fees. So they are looking at it as a holistic perspective. And our main idea is that usually school principals are very academic in their approach, that they want to improve student learning. And the perspective that we are bringing is to view the school as an organization and how do you make a low-fee private school into a thriving organization.
Thank you. Thank you. I don't think we have more time for the Q&A. So can we move into the support? Can we have support for this organization? And for the viewers, you can also support the organizations pitching today through the crowdfunding campaigns that they've set up.
Yeah, look, I'm happy to support this. I think this is a very, very, very important area, right? And we can debate on different ways to get there, but especially post-pandemic, I think there's a huge segment, you know. So look, at this point, I think I'm happy to support this. You know, I think you spoke of 5 lakhs, 1.5 lakhs. I think I'm happy to commit to right now, and let's see how it goes from there.
Following on Mukund and Ditto on that, I'm happy to support it to 1.5 lakhs.
Thank you, Vaisal. Thank you, and all the best.
Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, great work, Jonathan. I'm sure, you know, coming out of Harvard, there were many, many things you could do. The fact that you're doing this says a lot. Thank you. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks so much for all your support and kind words.
Thank you.
Thank you. So the next organization that we have, which we last in this tank, is Yash Charitable Trust. Sushma, can you give a presentation?
Good afternoon. Should I go ahead?
Yes, please share your screen.
Yes, Charitable Trust is Mumbai based.
Sushma, can you share your screen?
Have you given me the rights?
Yes.
Yes, we have the rights.
Oh. Seem to be able to. Okay. Got it. Should I go ahead?
Can you please turn on your camera?
turn on my camera. I thought it's on. Sorry, one second. Yeah.
And can you make the presentation full screen?
Yes, I will. Are we ready to go? Good afternoon. My name is Sushma Nagarkar.
One second. Sorry, I thought we were waiting for the screen to come up. Yes, Okay. Sorry. You can start now.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Sushma Nagarkar. I'm the founder trustee of Yash Charitable Trust. We work with adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities. These are adults with autism, Down syndrome, and etc. We are Mumbai-based, and the trust was launched in 2014 after Aarti and myself came back from a 15-year stay in the US. So the problem is that adults with these kinds of disabilities need significant support for multiple reasons. And unfortunately, as they become adults, the outcomes for them are really poor. And as you can see from the DASRA statistic up there, there are large numbers of these people within India itself. So our approach is based on a very strong belief system of acceptance and respect, inclusion, as well as empowerment. So the vision is that these adults have an opportunity to live and work in their own communities with dignity and self-respect. And towards this end, YCT runs two verticals. One of them focuses on skilling and providing supported employment. And the other one focuses on all the other wraparound services that are needed for adults with such significant supports. And as you can see, we have various activities under the two verticals. Our success cannot really be measured by numbers. We don't have large number of beneficiaries that we cater to. However, we do believe that the way we work and the model we have is replicable. And so larger numbers can be catered to. We do go deeper. So every individual who comes to us as an adult has significant concerns across multiple areas. And we try and help them live a happy, productive life where they are included and have high self-esteem. Currently, we do have 21 individuals who work with us in our supported employment initiatives, which is Cafe Arpan as well as Arpan Food Services. We provide training under our Skill Development Center for another 10 adults currently. Because of COVID, of course, counseling has become there's a larger need of counseling services. At the moment, we have 155 clients. Mm-hmm. And then we also run a small employment cell, and we've managed to place 3 people so far in open employment. Besides this, we do workshops, we do trainings, and we've reached over 900 participants since January. Our current ask is probably low, but we are struggling with meeting our goals and our need till the end of this financial year. Of course, we're open to further support as the case may be. Thank you.
Thank you. So can we move to the questions from the audience? Sushma?
Sorry, what was that?
Saying we can move to the questions from the dolphins if they have.
Oh, absolutely. Of course.
Yes.
I thought I had some questions, but I don't. Yeah. Go ahead.
Meeraji, you're on mute.
Meeraji, you're on mute.
Yeah, I've removed. So, Sushma, is your training center meant only for Cafe Arpan or is it open for other kids? Because I was just looking at the numbers.
Yeah, so we have the criteria for us is adults with developmental and intellectual disabilities only. So it's open for other individuals, and each individual who comes to us has a plan. And it may be for Cafe Arpan, it may be just to acquire the soft skills they require to go out and seek open employment. A lot of these people don't even have those in place. So we each plan is individualized. And that's why it's very resource intensive. But this is necessary for this population.
And you don't have more enrolling? Because I would imagine there are a lot of people who would require this kind of training.
Yeah, if I may call you Meera, there are a lot of people who do require this kind of training. Our bandwidth is low, but we can share whatever we do with whoever is interested. So we do collaborate with NGOs across the country as well in sharing, in knowledge sharing, particularly for this population. Again, let me reiterate.
Okay. Have you set up a robust sharing process where, you know, people know that if they get the knowledge which you have can reach them? Because yes, constantly we know that there is a demand for this in this space. Yes. So is there a documented process?
Yeah. Which so far, no, we have not set up a documented process as such. We're very, very careful because, you know, many of us who work at YCT, both in a consultant as well as a volunteer role, are professionals. And we're very careful about who we share with and how. But that being said, we are networked with NGOs in Coimbatore, Bangalore, Chennai, as well as locally here in Mumbai.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any more questions?
Just a question around beyond the ask that you have now. How do you see the next couple of years and what would be your challenges, if any?
So before COVID, we were very happy at the end of 2019, and there's a long story attached to that, but we opened a second cafe at Accenture, and they gave us a space, and we were successfully running another cafe at Accenture. It was a fantastic experience for the community at Accenture more so, and as well as us. So we would like to do this because we have a model that can be replicated. And we would like to do this across different corporates. COVID has put a tremendous dent in our operations at the moment. We are hopeful. We were in talks with other entities to do similar things on their corporate premises. So Accenture gave us space. They footed the electricity and everything else, all the bills. We were in an air-conditioned environment with fantastic people. Couldn't ask for more. So we're hopeful. F&B is a very, very good arena for persons that we work with. Mm. It can be extremely successful, and it totally fits.
Your biggest ask in some ways would be avenues to take some of the beneficiaries and get them the opportunity, right?
That's one thing. The second thing that we're also working on is also job placements. So our three success stories, if you will, one has been at Soho House, but it took us months of negotiation and training of staff. The other two have been at Ernst Young. And again, they have a very limited, they will only take, I hate to say this, but I'm just going to put it out there. They'll only take college educated persons with autism.
Yeah.
Whereas our gamut is really much larger than that.
Thank you.
We have time for just one more question, if anyone has questions for. Yes.
I have, I was wondering, I think it's a follow-up on COVID question, as to what are the constraints in becoming big or...
The constraints are at many levels, and I'll just give you one brief example. So when families come to us, they have this notion, having been through a school system and having been through, you know, years of trying to educate their individuals who may have low IQs or may have some other challenges, but who at the same time have many strengths. Families themselves often look at these individuals as persons who cannot, rather than looking at them as someone who has strengths in certain areas. And so those areas can be cultivated. YCT, which I failed to mention earlier, is very much a strength-based approach. So it's the constraints start even at the level of the caregivers. And then it sort of snowballs into just more, because these individuals often have had very negative experiences. We have currently three individuals who've come to us for our supported employment after having worked in the open employment space. They've been abused, either sexually or otherwise, verbally, and they are just scarred. And so we provide them counseling as well at the moment.
Thanks.
Thank you. So can we move into the support for the organization?
Yeah, I'll give 1 lakh.
Thank you.
And Sushma, I would like to, yeah, I'd also like to support you for the same amount.
I would like to support 2 lakhs.
Thank you. Thank you, Sushma. Thank you so much for joining us. And all
thank you
guests.
All.
For our viewers who are watching this, you wanted to say something. Go ahead.
No, I said, do I just leave at the
end? Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. For the viewers who are watching us live on Facebook, please donate if you like the organization switching and the work that they are doing through the crowdfunding links which are shared on Facebook. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you to all the dolphins, the participants, and the viewers who are watching us live. Hope you enjoyed the event as much as we enjoyed hosting it. Our next tank is at 2:30. Do join us.